recording. Okay. So, happy birthday, Daniel Libeskind. You are 75 years old today and still kicking, as they say. Yes, he's still very active. And I would say creative. Here is the man. As you know, he was born in Poland and then he immigrated to the United States. And, he had a very auspicious beginning in a way in architecture. Initially, from what I understood, he became a virtuoso in music. And because he wanted to challenge himself, he chose to give up on music, or well, not to follow on that path, because he had the feeling he arrived at a high level of accomplishment, and so he chose architecture. And he studied in a remarkable school, Cooper Union, which at that time was extremely experimental. And it was run by John Haydock, one of the New York Five, or the New York Whites, the other four being Peter Eisenman, Michael Graves, Richard Meyer, and Charles Guidemy. So, you know, he had a chance of a professional upbringing that was very, very, very open, and as I said, experimental. And so he was able to flourish. And his thoughts on education, he was an educator himself at Cranbrook Academy in the United States, and maybe he also teaches sometimes or taught sometimes in Europe. We will go through some of his thoughts on education, and I think they are valid. I think what he says is correct, and perhaps we should remember what he says. Also, he is doctor honoris causa at the University Ion Mincu in Bucharest. Some drawings. I remember I wrote violently against these drawings. He did these drawings. I think he was still in school. They irritated me beyond measure at the time when I first saw them. Now, when I look at them, I'm less critical, and I'm even appreciative. You know, I remember I accused him of being, a cold manipulator of form and exploding, but exploding in a rather frigid way. I wrote all kinds of things, and I didn't realize that actually, perhaps, I was projecting something from within me in him. And I believe Carl Jung, the great Swiss psychoanalyst, was right when he said that when we hate someone, or when we have a very strong negative, perception of someone. Often it is about what is called the Jungian shadow. You project something, you see yourself in the other person, and there is something of yourself which you dislike immensely. So you, by criticizing the other person, you actually criticize that part within you which is not brought to consciousness. There is this strange psychological setup. Anyway, but at that time, as Bernard Tschumi once wrote, I wrote very, very negatively against everybody. I felt I was some kind of, I know you can laugh, you are totally entitled to laugh. At that time, I really felt I was some kind of a Zorro in architecture, meant to bring justice to a falling system of values and so on. I think I was wrong. The very fact that now I make a presentation on Daniel Libeskind seems to say the same thing. The truth is, his drawings were very unusual at that time, and maybe still are. I mean, what are we looking at here? You know, is this architecture? Is this supposed to be architecture? Is architecture supposed to express stability and order, or instability and chaos? But at that time, I didn't realize the chaos within myself. And so, of course, the deconstructivist unsettled me terribly. But as the saying goes, you become what you hate. So in time, I became kind of a deconstructivist myself. Now, looking at the works, they are interesting. You know, they are explorations of something that might have nothing to do with architecture. But the truth is, the man builds, and he builds a lot. So obviously, he knows how to build. I also think that the influence of that school, Cooper Union, was positive, you know, because it's truly a school that promotes investigation and experimentation. And that's why we look at drawings which are almost inconceivable to be done in another kind of architecture school. Now, this is a drawing he did for the World Trade Center. He seems to have some kind of, in a way, too literal, a little bit too explicit, and maybe even, I don't want to be harsh now because it is his birthday, with a Statue of Liberty. At the end of the presentation, we'll see a post-pandemic or some kind of a memorial, you know, to the losses of this pandemic. Involving the Statue of Liberty. So he won this competition for the World Trade Center, but the tower itself was not built by him, but by David Childs from SOM, Skidmore, Owings & Merrill. But the competition was won by Libeskind. So he does graphic works, he does sculpture, he does music, I understood. He did, and probably he still does. He's a man who loves who has many interests. He has a very large library in his office. And I knew two young architects who worked for him, with him for 5 years. And they told me that, you know, that it was very common than to open books, to discuss ideas and so on. So the frontier, if it is a frontier between knowledge and doing, between knowing and doing, that frontier was diluted or even destroyed. And I admire this kind of practice because it's not enough just to do projects. You also have to know things about culture, about spirit, about theology, biology, music, literature, you name it. And because these things nourish your architecture, nourish your understanding of reality, of society and everything. And maybe that's why Wolf Prick said, if you only think of architecture, you only get architecture. And the last project I saw done by Kopp Himmelblau, that is, you know, the office of Wolf Prick, exemplified this quest for enlarging the realm of architecture. They won a competition in Russia where they found inspiration even in the traces of the ice skates of a famous Russian, you know, ice skater. And also they found inspiration in Lisitsky, in Tatlin's tower and so on. And I really think architecture is beautiful when it asserts itself as being part of culture. And I cannot ignore what Alvar Aalto said. Architecture belongs to culture, not to civilization. A very surprising, to me, a very surprising statement coming from a rather, you know, taciturn and reticent Scandinavian. But Alvar Aalto said this, architecture belongs to culture, not to civilization. This is a very abrupt statement, and I think we should think about it. What did he mean? But I would say that Libeskind would have agreed or would agree with Alvarado. And, you know, the exploration is of course, architecture is a technical realm, but it's, when it becomes architecture, it becomes art. So the relationship between art and architecture is cannot be denied. If we deny that, we deny the very essence of architecture. And, you know, to people who question themselves and question others, if architecture is an art or is a science, I would say, open any history of art or almost any history of art, and architecture is there, sometimes on the very first pages. Why, if it's not an art? And open any history of science, and architecture is not there. So, you know, of course there is a so-called scientific side to architecture, but when architecture deserves its name, it becomes art. And we have to acknowledge this, and I think we have to allow our artistic side to manifest itself as openly and as strongly as possible, because there is, in a way, the very essence of architecture. So I like the fact that Libeskind explored the, you know, graphic realms of investigation that might have nothing to do apparently with architecture, like this. Well, this does, and we'll see buildings that are very similar to this sketch, and unfortunately, he has a number of them quite similar. He began, after he finished Cooper Union, he was employed, he actually ran the architecture department at Cranbrook Academy, so he worked in the academic field. And then in 1993, he took part in this competition for the Potsdamer Platz with a housing scheme. And he, surprisingly, he won. And that competition, the City Edge competition, was the open door for him towards the successes that followed. And that project was part of the deconstructivist exhibition in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, together with the other six deconstructivists. They were seven. So now we look at some images of that proposal, and we can realize what we see here actually is a physical representation of his belief that architecture should tell a story. We look at how the skin of the buildings is narrative in a way. You know, it has these many fragmentations which seem to be kind of a writing. And the relationship between writing and architecture, I think, is a complex one, and perhaps a necessary one. And I recently became aware of the fact that a student sent me a link about preoccupation at Harvard for bringing back writing into architecture. And this made me think of what Victor Hugo said, that the book killed the cathedral, and now the book is under siege by the web, the internet, and it's very possible that somehow the book will return to the world. I don't know in what form, but the fact that recently there are such preoccupations in a school like Harvard shows that indeed there seems to be a new interest in the relationship between writing and architecture. That what he did here would be, almost incomprehensible in most more conventional architectural climates, but this is creativity. You unsettle. I was unsettled myself, but he won, and what followed for him was highly successful. There was a strong, almost violent reaction against postmodernism. That's what the deconstructivists did. They tried to replace postmodernism, and actually they succeeded. at that time, I thought that it was just a fashion, you know, but it was not a fashion at all. In fact, all the seven architects who were present in that exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art continue to make waves, so to speak, in architecture and be very relevant. And that is 30 years later. So, you know, Rem Koolhaas does it. Peter Eisenman, I don't know if he works right now. He's 88, but he did it for a good number of years. Libeskind does it. Zaha Hadid did it. And she continues to do it after death through her large office. Kop Himmelblau does it. Bernard Tschumi does it. So all these people actually continue to be significant presences in today's architectural climate. So it means it wasn't just a fashion. Now, I know that Patrick Schumacher thought that postmodernism and deconstructivism were just some kind of intermediate stages between various so-called modernistic styles and what he called parametrics, which itself has, in his understanding until now, about five or six zones or stages. An interesting understanding of the modern movement, you know, where he identified various currents, or I don't know how to call them, at the beginning of modernism, at the beginning of the 20th century, then in the 90s, in the 80s, postmodernism, in the 90s, deconstruction, and now in the 21st century, parametrics with various kinds of manifestations, the last one being what he called tectonism. So this is the project for the City Edge in Berlin, and it was not built, but the project made waves, and yes, today we talk about the author of this project. And that's why we talk about him, because he brought something new in the world of architecture. And, you know, I keep saying to the students, you know, it's not enough to follow the, you know, the already established or known road. You have to contribute to the world of architecture with something that is within you, hopefully, and do it as powerfully, as strongly, as skillfully, as honestly as you can. And then, who knows, something might happen. Now we arrive at this very important work by him. In fact, it was the work that established him as a force in architecture, the Jewish Museum in Berlin. I went there two or three times, and I actually never entered. I mean, I did enter in the old building where he also covered the courtyard. But for some reason, I didn't make it all the way through the rooms. But I know the project kind of well. It's a zigzagging metallic, you know, snake. And I think it is skillfully done. I forgot it has 1,000 or 11,000 different windows, all different from each other. I made it all the way here inside this. So from here you can enter the zigzagging snake, as I call it. It's covered in zinc. It's it has a cold skin, but then the function of the building couldn't be, you know, in a bucolic way warm. So not far away from this building, there are several buildings by his beloved professor, John Haydock. He built a few housing, two apartment buildings and, smaller, buildings near it. It's interesting that you can see from the position where the student, his former student, built his museum, the works of the professor somewhere, looking this way or to the right, if you see my arrow. And unfortunately, this was a first statement done by Libeskind, where he has these windows that are almost negating the very idea of a window. They are graphically enticing, but he repeats this quite often. So I don't know, there might be a problem, but then when you invent such a radical language, you cannot go back to the traditional windows. It's probably difficult, if not impossible. So it's possible that this open space, he is actually having the name of a poet born in Romania, a very, very important poet, Paul Celan, of whom I learned myself late, unfortunately, but he was considered one of the most important poets of the second half of the 20th century. And in fact, Deleuze thought that he was placed actually, Paul Celan, in the vicinity of Goethe and Hölderlin, not a little thing at all. So, yes, when are we going to make references to poetry, and not just to poetry, in our architecture? You know, when are we going to read poetry? When are we going to write poetry? Why is it that architects always choose or very often choose a very dry language, very analytical, but not synthetical, not lyrical, not poetical, not emotional? And it wasn't always like this. Like Bruno Taut wrote in a very, very warm and exalted way. And the great architects like Wright and Le Corbusier and Kahn, who was a mystic in his writings, they all talked about architecture in a language that was far from being dry and excessively analytical and rational. And I do think it is important for those who practice architecture and study architecture to look into their hearts and explore what is there, and then externalize through words or lines, because I think an excessive interest in the brain and the language of the brain is very detrimental to architecture. I think if architects begin again to write manifestos, write poems, to express themselves emotionally, the more emotion, the better. I think we need emotions, because without emotions, we arrive at sterility, at frigidity, and we don't need that, do we? Of course, someone like Daniel Libeskind showed what you can do when you break conventions and when you explore unexplored realms that could have to do with architecture. What I don't quite understand, and in fact I asked a friend of mine who is an architect trained in Romania but he lives in Austria, why did Libeskind go back, in a way, not back, go to Germany? I mean, the country that in a way tormented him, because the Holocaust and so on was provoked by not in small measure by the country he chose to live in. And in the same way, Paul Celan was writing in German, although he lost all his family in the Holocaust. And I don't know. I still have this question: why did Libeskind choose? Well, he ran away from Poland and went to the United States. Then he returned to Europe, not to Poland, but to Germany. So he replaced one tormenting country, that is Poland, for the Jewish population, with another tormenting, to use maybe a gentle word, country towards them, that is Germany. I was told that maybe this was a gesture of showing that they were not all exterminated. I don't know. Anyway, but Germany was and is very good to him. They built this museum. He is having a very successful practice in Berlin. he built in Berlin besides this building. So anyway, things are complex. But this is an interesting is an interesting project, you know. And the more I look at it, the more I realize that he's trying to express architecturally a deep pain. It's a building. It's the house of grief in a way. I think it pays to be radical, because if you are not, you know, you might, you know, so-called survive, but are you truly living? I truly think all great architects were radical, even the more gentle ones, you know, they were radical. You have to be to make it to the pages of the histories of architecture, otherwise you'll remain, you know, in lukewarm waters, but you don't bring anything new to architecture. And thus, through you, through your work, culture does not advance. But how to do it, that's not an easy question, of course. It's not enough just to be radical. You also have to sustain your radical vision with hard work and with talent, with inspiration, with seriousness. So it's not just that, you know, you are just radical, you know, doing nothing, watching the soap opera on TV and being radical. No, it won't work. It requires passion. Mainly passion. And I keep repeating to myself, and I keep repeating it to others, what Frank Lloyd Wright said: talent is good, practice is better, passion is best. Because if you have passion, then the other things will follow. But if you don't have passion, well, even the talent vanishes and the practice becomes useless. Interesting picture here, you know, an old artifact, and then the building by Libeskind behind. Now the national, I have to apologize. This presentation, as I said, is not as good as it could have been and as it should have been. There are a few repetitions. And the works are not in a chronological order, but so I apologize for this deficiency. You will see another part within the presentation about this, the National Holocaust Monument in Ottawa. I show it here also because it's in the proximity of the Jewish museum that he built. So this was the project, and it was built, and we are going to see it. Now we look at this work that he did in China, the eternally experimental China. I mean, it's a recent, you know, only recently we can talk about this phenomenon, of course. But to those of us who keep invoking communism as being the anguishing negative force in our being blocked, I would say, why is it that China is not blocked? They had a more difficult form of communism than other countries, and still they are doing incredible things now, incredible mistakes as well, because they raise mountains overnight, and you know, they try to achieve a level of so-called progress in a very, very short time, and inevitably they make mistakes. This, in my opinion, is not one of the great buildings by Daniel Libeskind. It's a little bit burlesque for my taste. I don't take it too seriously, but he built it. So, and there is a side in his work, and we are going to see it also in other works, that is, in my opinion, a little bit problematic. I like the structure, though. You know, the visceral structure, it does have vigor, and unfortunately, when it was covered, it's hidden, and the building is as it is. Anyway, in my opinion, is not one of his best buildings. Otherwise, of course, we have the surfaces that refuse to submit to the rigors of the T-square or the rectangle, and that's it. Now, of course, here the engineer is also important, but I like to think that a good engineer likes to be provoked in as much as and be provocative himself in as much as the architect. You know, I know that the director of the Institute of Architecture in Vienna, which is one of the most radical architecture schools in the world, is run by a German engineer who builds a lot, Klaus Berlinger. And I know that if we see projects done in that school, we don't believe that an engineer would allow for such, not only that he allows them, he encourages them. Because I know a student told me from there that he wants to be provoked too, he wants to be creative. And a good engineer, yes, is not happy to just follow the easiest so-called solution. Wants to invent, to create. Anyway, a sketch by him. The truth is, some of the sketches by Libeskind are indeed, as someone described them yesterday in the article I read, feeble. But he is interested in important themes, you know, the history, the future, the timeline. So are we reflecting enough about time in our projects? Maybe not as much as we could. So we see that dynamic spiral. Well, spirals are usually dynamic. Anyway, this is a page with sketches for the building that you just saw. In my opinion, not one of his greatest works. Now, Centre de Congrès, we are going to look at it in detail a little later. In Belgium, this is the project. Or is it? I am a little bit confused because sometimes the renderings are so good that you don't know, is it the built work? It might be the built work, but it could also be, this is a rendering. Anyway, we are going to look at the work a little bit later. This work also, in my opinion, is not one of his best works, but this is my opinion. It doesn't mean I'm right. This is what I think. Okay, I mean, it is a little bit, sleek and almost placid for my taste. But this pavilion built for China, actually, it's a Chinese pavilion that Daniel Libeskind built for China in Milan in 2015, is not bad. I like it. It's a dragon. It's a red dragon. In my opinion, it has only one problem, but that is seen only from a certain distance from the building, and we are going to arrive at it. Otherwise, if we look at this plan, it's indeed fluid. And so, although he is considered the king of the angle, because he does use sharp angles in his architecture, here you might almost say he's the king of fluidity, or if not the king, a good practitioner of fluidity or fluidities. This is the problem I see with this building. If I am to mention the problem today when he's 75 years old, the very flat ending of the building at the top. You know, it's a dragon, all right, but when you arrive at this, it's not a dragon any longer. It's as if the head of the dragon was cut. So in my opinion, that is a problem. Otherwise, the building is interesting and convincing and enticing and exciting. And yes, this is an intrinsic problem of architecture. We aspire towards fluidities, but we still would rather walk on a flat slab. And even architects who build caves or cave-like buildings today, they appear to be cave-like, but within the so-called cave, the flooring is flat. The walking surface is flat. Not too many caves in reality are like this. Otherwise, I think this building is good. And you already see the so-called problem that I mentioned, that it's forced, this cutting, you know, this horizontality at the top. But otherwise, and from some parts, it looks quite fine. You see, that is the problem, you know. It is a dragon as long as you don't arrive here. When you arrive here, you realize that it's not a dragon, you know. That you'll never see a dragon like this, nor a snake, or unless you cut, you know, you cut the body of the snake or the dragon. But anyway, but when we look at this, it's nice, you know. It's organic. It's rigorous at the same time. You know, can you imagine? You know, each piece is different. So all of this, you know, without the digital technologies would not have been built. It would have been very, very difficult to build something like this in the absence of the digital technologies. I mean, this man, when he was young, was playing the accordion, and he grew up, I guess, in a family with appreciation for the past, and he himself appreciates the past, but he also embraces the new. And without embracing the new, you would never be able to do something like this. This is the project. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, it was built. And look at the structure. And it is my belief that a good building, it doesn't matter the stage when one takes photographs of, it still looks interesting and enticing, because the spirit of the building is even in the parts that are not yet in full light, so to speak, or finalized. He is blessed with many commissions, and in fact, he said that he could have enlarged a lot the number of employees in his office, and he could have received many more commissions, but he wanted to have a control on the works that are done in his office, so he wanted his office not to go beyond a certain limit in terms of the number of people employed, and also not to accept more commissions than he could have handled by himself. And so maybe there is a degree of wisdom in his limiting the growth of his office. But still has, you know, he can choose what kind of work he wants to do. And, you know, it does pay to risk, to take risks in architecture. And we'll arrive at some words that he has about this. Look how impeccable this is being built. You know, this was built. You know, it's almost magical. You know, it's free, but it's also rigorous. And it's something that enchants the eye and perhaps also the soul in a way. Now, the Serpentine Pavilion, which is different in London, but it's not 2021, there's something wrong there. It was built earlier. This is the Serpentine Pavilion. What can we say? The Serpentine Pavilions, as you know, they are experimental, and you know, important architects are invited to build a pavilion, and after 1 year, that pavilion goes away. I hope it's not destroyed, but it's said in a way that it's rather ephemeral. But then, life itself is, I guess, ephemeral. So here he is, yes, the man of the angles, the knight of the angles, if not the king of the angles. These people experiment. You know, I'm thinking of Frank Gehry. He's over 90, I don't know, 92, 93, still working and still, you know, attempting to do something new, although sometimes inevitably perhaps they repeat themselves a little bit, but all in all, it's amazing that at such an age they continue to work. The new Lithuanian Modern Art Center, it was built here. You see the project, here is the architect with a model. I hope he's not wearing his famous pair of cowboy boots made of lizard leather, a strange choice. And we are going to see a picture of his favorite pair of shoes, an eccentricity. And I wonder what a psychoanalyst might say about the choice of that extravagant pair of boots. Anyway, this is the building in the rendering, and that's how it was built. You see, it's more, and I find freshness in the fact that in this case, you know, the top is rectangular, using orthogonal lines, rectangular, the rectangularity is not banished. And so the box is broken, but it's also, it can be read as a construct that is not alarmingly, you know, unsettling. It's fine. I think he did a building here that is not a shame to the city. As there are still parts which connect with what we already saw by him and will continue to see. Well, as for the art that is displayed within the building, what can we say? If I have any reticence, if I am to express a reticence vis-a-vis his work, is this sometimes excessive whiteness and slickness within the building. But this building is also white outside. So in my what I'm trying to say is, if you are visceral, why do you express viscerality only in the handling of the volumes and the handling of the lines and the surfaces, and not also in the materials you are using? You know, most, and this is a problem with deconstructivism. Deconstructivism is very emotional and even violent, but the violence is not expressed tectonically, is expressed graphically, almost bidimensionally, I mean paradoxically, because if you have violence, you know, what kind of a white violence that is, you know, or a sleek violence, you know, or a graphic violence in architecture. More is needed, I would say. And I remember what Zaha Hadid said, that she was searching, she wanted to make an architecture that was raw, earthy or earthly and vital. Now, maybe a level of vitality she achieved, but otherwise her work was certainly not raw, R-A-W, nor earthly. It was not. She didn't arrive at that. Maybe she would have arrived if she lived longer. The Kurdistan Museum in Erbil, this was not built as far as I know. Yes, it is a project by Daniel Libeskind. I'll have some other images by it. Now this work, the tower he proposed in Jerusalem, makes me wonder, because the deconstructivist was supposed to be an architect who if we are to talk about architects, because deconstructivism actually originated in philosophy and in literature, not in architecture. Derrida was a philosopher and a writer, but it arrived in architecture. And strangely, here we have one of the deconstructivists proposing a pyramid. I mean, look at this. This is almost a symbol of power, of authority, of almost autocracy, or even theocracy. It is a building which, in my opinion, is opposite to what deconstruction was supposed to mean. I mean, look at its base. You know, this is almost Philip Johnson. It's very, predictably and almost in a mimicking some kind of a so-called classical language. How could this be? You know, again, you know, I wonder now. Of course, we become what we hate. The deconstructivist hated authority and exploded violently against authority. But look now, later, the deconstructivist, seems to come to terms with a certain kind of centrality, because that's what this building symbolizes, centrality. In fact, it's the paradigmatic form of centrality, the pyramid. Look at this. I'm not convinced at all about Dan Libeskind here. I'm sorry that it is his birthday. But, what are we looking at here, you know? Anyway, moving forward. Vilnius Beacon, this is a project he didn't build. But you see, once you establish yourself as a creator someone original who has a vision, so to speak, in architecture, commissions flood you. This is a sketch, I don't know what to think. Some of his sketches, although he is a cultured man and I think a sensitive man, but some of his sketches, maybe because of the multitude of commissions he receives, seem to be to me a little cartoonish, even this one. Here he is, immensely happy with his cowboy boots. Of course he is immensely happy because he earned his youthfulness, you know, through creativity. And I keep telling myself and telling everybody continuously that the task is, as Le Corbusier described it, not to remain young, but to become young. And I think it's possible that Libeskind became young. I mean, he must have been here 60 years old man or so. And look at him, he laughs like a kid. Bravo to him. Yes, monsieur, you did it. We agree, you did it. Yes, you did it. Okay, Casa Origami. This is a house that is kind of like the other buildings he built and continues maybe to build, but it has one problem. Just like that dragon pavilion for China and in Milan, I will mention here a small problem, so to speak. So the building, it is like this, and I like what is happening here, you know, is this flood, ornamental flood, this, I imagine they were part of what he proposed. But I like this fact that, you know, he welcomes the contradiction of what ornament is supposed to be. This is a building built for on an exhibition ground, it was not built for a specific client. But what do we see here? We see nature, we see trees, we see the sky, we see the grass, and then we see the work of a human being rather anxiously proclaiming some kind of almost angst, you know, it's a work that shows distress. But within the building, there is something else. And I hope I have an image with that so-called something else. Otherwise, this is very similar formally to the Serpentine Pavilion and other works he did. We are still here, although there is an anticipation for what is to come. We look at those books there on the shelves. They are rather, placidly sitting there. And here is okay, although, you know, you wonder, you know, this large glass wall, does it belong to a house or to some kind of a public building? Now, this was the image I wanted to arrive at, because in my opinion, it's just like in the works of Frank Gehry, in those works where he has, bedrooms and so on. I just don't understand how l'homme révolté, no? The revolted man, the man who is deconstructing the world in order to start anew in the name of those beginnings that Louis Kahn claimed are in harmony with the human nature. This interior is so bourgeois in the worst sense of the word that I just don't believe it. I mean, look at the bed, look at the symmetry of, look at the, these lamps left and right. Now he might not be, although I don't think this was done without his knowledge. It's just that there is something pathetical about this bedroom, which is so self-satisfied in its mediocre bourgeois, complacency that this has nothing to do with what is outside the building. It's the most conventional kind of thing within a building which attempts to be unconventional. But then even this diagonal here, they are rather, superfluous. But then we remember what Voltaire said, that superfluousness is a very necessary thing. But I think there are several kinds of superfluousnesses. Superfluousnesses, maybe, or you understand. It's possible to be superfluous in various ways. This one, in my opinion, is not the most convincing. But the bed is outrageous. In fact, if there is something radical with a minus sign in front of it, in this building, is this bed. I mean, this bed is truly avant-garde with, I'm sarcastic now. Anyway, and look at this building and look at this bed. They are two different worlds altogether. I only hope that it wasn't him who placed this bed here, although I imagine he designed or someone in his office this platform. Who cares that these are slanted a little bit? In essence, it's a very conventional and bothering bourgeois little bed. Well, not so little. Anyway, moving forward. Happy birthday, Daniel Libeskind. I mean, look at this, no? Look at this, this sharp triangle, and then this bed. It's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. Anyway, so this is a private house supposed to be, although it is on some kind of a public, it's in the public realm because it's an item in an exhibition, was built for an exhibition. Maybe this is his dream house or an ideal house, an ideal Daniel Libeskind house. Something unconvincing here, the library and particularly the bedroom, as I said. Otherwise, of course, this is a Daniel Libeskind building. We move forward. It's even he's not afraid to use blackness or something approximating blackness. Now, this is an older work, actually. I think it was built after the Jewish Museum or before it even. It might be that this was actually his first built work, and I like it. I think it is one of his best works, an early work in Osnabrück for an important painter Felix Nussbaum. Here again, he seems to welcome, well, to put it very, very simply, he likes conflict. He likes to build in the proximity or even intersecting old buildings. So here we have an old building, and this is what he proposed and built near it. So he likes the old in order to have something to react against. He uses wood here, which is almost a very rare event in his architecture, as far as I know. And I like the fact that he uses this, aging wood, and reminds me of some houses Louis Kahn built. I think this is a problem with the deconstructivists. Very, very rarely they used organic materials, natural materials. But here, Libeskind used it, and I think it's a positive thing. Well, he also used, his palette of different kinds of materials. But I like this window here, capricious as it is. It reminds me a little bit of some works by Chinese architect who intrigues us with the name of his office, amateur architect, Wang Shu. So it is a box, yes, it is a box, but he breaks the box with his windows, and also, again, the wooden box, I think, is more pleasant than a metallic one, because even if it is a box, the wood by itself, the material itself, breaks the very idea of a box, because it's natural. And God didn't make too many boxes, did he? So this is a very early work by Libeskind. Now, Libeskind in New York City. My New York City, he expressed himself about, he expressed something that, which I believe is true. He thought that in a way, New York City is an imago mundi. And I think it's true. I lived there and I know it's a condensation of, in its essence and in its way of manifesting itself, the city is not actually a North American city. It's a city that belongs to the world and expresses the whole world. And here he is with the former here the governor and the mayor, Bloomberg, and here is the magician, trying to sell his tower, the World Trade Center Tower, and he succeeded, but was not built by him. Instead, SOM built it through David Charles. And anyway, yes, there was a big, big project and a big, attempt of these frustrated children, if I am to call them so, to renew New York City after the said event. When the two towers fell. Now, whom do we see here? On the right is Richard Rogers. Then, of course, Sir Norman Foster cannot miss it. And here is the proud Daniel Libeskind, then the governor of New York. Then this is the developer, I forgot his name. And here, more reticent, Fumihiko Maki, the Japanese architect. So we have here four Pritzker Prize laureates. 1, 2, 3, 4. I didn't double check, but I think Libeskind got it too. And I'm sure of the other three. Anyway, what disturbs me a little bit is that with the exception of Fumihiko Maki, they are all having fun forgetting that more than 3,000 people died there. And this I quite don't quite understand, this was a very tragic event. And look at them. He is laughing, he is smiling, he is smiling, he is smiling, he is smiling. The only one who is not quite smiling is the more reticent Fumihiko Maki. But something is wrong with these males, I am sorry. Did they forget what happened here? anyway, you could say life goes on, life moves on. I'm not so sure about that. And plus, Libeskind is supposed to be a man who understands things in the perspective of history and memory, and he commemorates, he builds memorials. How could you laugh like this, you know, or smile? I don't understand it. Anyway, this is World Trade Center. This is the tower built. They struggled in New York City for a long time, and they built it. And this is what, of course, the eternally, the ubiquitous Bjarke Ingels proposed, and it was not built, and I'm happy it was not built. He has to be everywhere, that man, of course. What can we say? Bansky thought that this tower belonged to Canada, not to New York City and not to the United States. It's probably built to last forever, but architecturally it's rather, you know, blunt and simplistic. Anyway, a lot of glorification here and a lot of public relations and a lot of politics, of course. He handled them, of course, Daniel Libeskind. This is the sketch he did. In my opinion, and again, happy birthday, Daniel Libeskind, but I would say he, and maybe this is, explaining to an extent his success, there is a degree of opportunism in his dealings with architecture and society, and maybe that is necessary. I don't know. But I like very much his library. You know, he uses, you know, this very simple and cheap, I would say, you know, shelving system that one can buy even from Dedeman, perhaps. And yes, I think an architecture office that has some has books like this is a blessed office. And I see even a book here about Islam. You know, he's Jewish, but here, right here, is a book about Islam. And why not? Of course, you know, one has to know, and there is a lot of beauty here. And I'm glad that this book exists here, or L'Art Maya. Maya art. I keep telling the students, you need to know. And it's not that I am saying it. The way Le Corbusier said it very plainly, that the architect is supposed to be a very, very cultured person, not for the sake of accumulating facts, but to have a cultivated heart. This was the expression. A cultivated heart. And you cannot have a cultivated heart if you ignore history, philosophy, theory, and so on, you know. So this man, maybe he didn't read all these books. I'm sure he didn't. But he has them on his shelves. And it shows that he had and has this intense dialogue with culture. Now, I don't know about those cowboy boots, if indeed they show an intense, but we all have eccentricities, I guess, and that is his. Actually, this pair here is not as extravagant. I think I have another picture where he is even more indulging, so to speak. Anyway, I think he earned his youthfulness. That's what I feel. The Denver Museum of Art, the unavoidable sharp triangle is right here for all to see. This is in Denver. Unfortunately, he repeats it a little bit too often, but this is his maniera. What can we do? It seems it works. For him, it works. I am asking myself, does he build this in order to show that art is some kind of a scream in the desert, that art is something that tries to awaken, society, to show us the other side of things, perhaps. But what puzzles me is that he used this shape almost literally, the same for a museum of the military in Germany, in Dresden, and we are going to see it. So there is not art. So I'm a little bit confused. But of course, the military and the war that is stood for and stands for is another kind of violence. So I guess we have various kinds of violence, the violence of art, the violence of war. And maybe that's why Lebesgue said architecture is war, although I don't quite feel comfortable with that, but maybe I'm not courageous enough. So the section through the Denver Museum of Art. Yes, art in its essence, in a way, problematizes what we think life is about and unsettles us. That's why, you know, in the 19th century, the greatest painters in Paris and in France couldn't make it into the official salon. And so they had to exhibit their works in Le Salon des Indépendants, the independent ones, those who were promoting the new, bringing the new in. And, you know, the situation didn't change so much. Although the genius of capitalism, or one side of the genius of capitalism, if we are to call it so, is that capitalism understood one thing, that instead of throwing the avant-garde artist or architect in prison, better buy it, better buy him. And that's what they do. Capitalism buys the avant-garde artist or the architect, and thus caresses the cat to death. Because the avant-gardist will not protest any longer when he receives a salary of almost $200,000 a year. Like the important Romanian theater director, Andrei Sherban. He lost his nerve when he was chosen to be the director of the Graduate School of Theater at Columbia. So, capitalism is very good at this. If someone stands out through some kind of extravagant, violent gesture, instead of negating that one, capitalism embraces that one and caresses him or her to death. And, you know, it works. And I think it works with Daniel Libeskind too, at least to an extent. It's very difficult to remain critical when you are, you know, applauded and, caressed and, when your pocket is filled with the riches that capitalism is so good at producing for some. Life, that IT is not necessary, but if this is what he said, life is not just a series of calculations and the sum total of statistics. It's about experience. It's about participation. It is something more complex and more interesting than what is obvious. Well, this is kind of obvious what you said, Daniel Libeskind. Anyway, architecture is not based on concrete and steel and the elements of the soil. It's based on wonder. I would agree here. Yes, the concrete and the steel and the soil are elements used in architecture, but to provoke wonder or enchantment is very important indeed. And unfortunately, we often forget about that, about the enchantment. How many students and how many architects think about enchantment? You know, but without enchantment, what is life? It becomes unbearable. So this man, yes, you did it. You are like the kid who did something bad, but got away with it. You know, like Elizabeth Diller said, also a very important architect whose parents were born in Poland from the office of Diller, Scofidio and Refro. She said that the trick The trick in life is, or in architecture, is to be outrageous but not offensive. Something that is very difficult to do. I'm not good at this, but I think there is wisdom in what she said. To be outrageous but not offensive. In his office in Berlin, Museum of Contemporary Art in Milan. This was a project done around the time when he did that pavilion for China, the dragon one, and we can see they are very similar. I don't know if this was built. So, moving forward, this is not a dragon, but there are similarities with that project. Here we have some other rendering with Leonardo there on the terrace, on the flat terrace, on the terrace jardin, or not so jardin. Okay, crystals for MGM Mirage City Center, Las Vegas. I never went to Las Vegas and I never wished to go to Las Vegas. I don't understand how Venturi could write a book learning from Las Vegas. There is nothing to learn from Las Vegas, unless you want to learn about, financial speculations, casinos, and all that destitute life. You know, I am very surprised that an educated architect like Venturi found inspiration in Las Vegas. But I learned about other architects who also find Las Vegas fascinating. In my opinion, it is not fascinating, not just in the field of ethics, but also in the field of aesthetics. Anyway, he built here a building which I understood was sold or was supposed to sell for more than $1 billion. Maybe it was sold, you know. Here it is. You know, here is the deconstructivist Boeing, actually, in front of the money machine, a speculative machine of Las Vegas. You know, I don't know. Is this that architecture that belongs to culture that Alvar Aalto claimed architecture is supposed to be? I'm not so sure. Yes, you know, maybe it's interesting formally, but I cannot forget that this is Las Vegas, a parasite city that lives actually of theft, because this is what casinos do. I spent some time and some money myself losing everything, the little I had in Atlantic City. So I know what a casino is. It's a place which makes money on the poor human beings who have thrills losing money. That's what Las Vegas is. Is it cultural? I doubt it. I have a different conception about culture. I'm sorry, Daniel Libeskind. But one, I guess, has to pay for the cowboy boots made of lizard leather, you know, or skin. Yeah. In my opinion, it is sad, but what can we do? And yet, yeah, again, this triangular, astute, architectural exuberance, which is saying what? In the case of the museum in Denver, I would say it was legitimate. But here what? What is the meaning? Is the triangle of spirit? Is it a longing for God? Is it a longing for creativity? No, it's a longing for shopping. I shop, therefore I am. I shop until I drop. You know, it's so he uses the same form indiscriminately. And I think that's a problem. I am very sorry. Now the spaces might be interesting, but the stair is rather conventional in my opinion. Just like that bed in that house, which I cannot forget. Anyway, Las Vegas, for those who can afford to buy from Louis Vuitton, you know, where you buy a belt for the trousers with thousands of euros or dollars. Can you imagine? Well, you better imagine it, because it's true. Anyway, this is not, this doesn't attract me, and I hope it's not just, you know, I reject something that I don't have access to now. Anyway, maybe I'm a purist. I don't think I am, though. Okay, moving forward from Las Vegas, look at it, you know, and then we complain that we have climate change, that we have a problem with energy consumption, that we have all kinds of excesses that melt down the icebergs and so on. Even Libeskind himself, you'll see at the last works I show in this presentation, is very concerned about the climate. Well, Mr. Libeskind, if you were so concerned, why did you build that monstrous thing in Las Vegas? You know, this city itself is an example of the excesses of a human being that is, you know, unable to control himself or herself. Origami Swan, nice. It's a play with paper. It's fine. It's pure, it's innocent, and it's fine if it remains here at the level of being just paper, although paper means cutting down trees. Yakov Chernikov, a less-known Russian constructivist who influenced not just Bernard Tschumi, but I would say also Libeskind. This is a drawing that Chernikov did. I forgot in what year, at the beginning of the 20th century. And yes, I would say that that Libeskind's work and also Bernard Tschumi's work earlier in his career had some connections with what Chernikov did. Anyway, we saw this one, the Jewish Museum, the Kurdistan Museum in Iraq, which was not built. It's a project. The pyramid in Jerusalem, we already saw, but we are going to see some other images of this disturbing bow in front of centrality, in my opinion. I hope he doesn't build it. I think Jerusalem doesn't deserve this, but then even Herzog and de Meuron proposed something not very different in Paris. You know, the defenders of freedom, of liberté, égalité, fraternité, actually have no problem at all to propose these very tall and crushing, actually, pyramids that express, in fact, the very opposite of those three words, liberté, égalité, fraternité. I mean, look at North Korea. What's the difference between this and this? There is a little bit of a difference, but not a major difference. I'm sorry, Mr. Libeskind. This is what you are aspiring towards? Maybe, but if you do, then we should have a talk. Other drawings, other smiles. And now the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto, which I think is one of his best works. The language is the same, but here he is able to crystallize it, I think, in a very convincing way. And I'm happy they built it. And it's the typical conflict that he advocates, the tension between his building and it's more than a tension, actually. It's war, it's conflict, and the old building. Of course, there are very appealing pictures of this building. Now, here I might understand it, but in Las Vegas, you know, it's a contradiction in a way to make a tormenting and tormented building that has as a function shopping and buying. At least here we are having to do with art, which is supposed to be rebellious. No, he did a good job, I think. And unfortunately, he repeats this kind of design in other locations and for other even other functions. Even for a war museum or a military museum, and that to me is a little bit unsettling. So we are in Toronto. This was a sketch, one of his better sketches as well, and one of his better buildings, in my opinion. Now, the winning design for the Canadian National Holocaust Monument in Ottawa, we are going to see that work. He built it. Later on, the Cincinnati apartment building is an interesting apartment building in a city with problems. I saw it from far when I visited for a day Cincinnati. And I don't know if Cincinnati is the place for some kind of architectural expressionism, but I think this building has something that is not bad, because it has the spiral movement, and you know, it's certainly very different from the building at the bottom right and the buildings on the left. So this is in Cincinnati, Ohio. Now, the deconstructivists, as a rule, they didn't care for context. And in this case, I'm happy he didn't. Now we are arriving at a complex of buildings in Singapore. Some architects from Indonesia told me that Singapore is the Switzerland of Southeast Asia. So we are dealing here with a thrill of wealth. Look at this. Who said that life is difficult or bad, right? Beautiful people, a beautiful boat or ship. Everything is beautiful. The idyllic waterfront living by the marina. Unfortunately, in my opinion, I know, happy birthday to you, Daniel Libeskind, but in my opinion, you should not be allowed or not encouraged to build skyscrapers. I don't think Daniel Libeskind can build skyscrapers. These skyscrapers are not really skyscrapers. They are flaccid. They are flaccid. They are, you know, a skyscraper has to have a verticality, an intrinsic verticality. Of course, they are going upwards, but in my opinion, they are flaccid. I'm very surprised that they were built, and I'm very surprised that Singapore didn't. In my opinion, there is more verticality in these low buildings than in his towers. Although factually, they are much taller. But it's my opinion, and I have seen others. In my opinion, Libeskind is not good at building towers. And look at the sketch. This is, in fact, the sketch that architect thought that it was feeble. It's true, it is feeble. It is weak. But it is a certain kind of weakness. It's nothing wrong with weakness. But this is, a sketch that, in my opinion, without glory. Anyway, he built them. Why? Because Singapore can. It's very rich, so they can build anything. But I like his attitude in this picture, and I see that, you know, there is only one book here with a cover oriented towards the viewer, and that is Edgar Allan Poe. The poet, the North American poet who died young and in rather, tragic circumstances. The dark poet of North America, Edgar Allan Poe. Otherwise, maybe he likes Edgar Allan Poe. Anyway, He does look a little bit like a teenager here, although he's probably, you know, around 50 or something like this. On the other hand, here they are. Yes, you did them. You know, the developer and Libeskind. Yes, you are very proud of it. But my question is, what are you proud of? Those towers, the flashy towers? Yes, you made a lot of money, I'm sure, because, you know, who can afford to live here? You know, the people with money. But what's so glorious, really? I think the towers are weak. Look at them, you know, they are bent. They are, I should not continue to describe them, but I don't think they deserve that great sign of happiness, in my opinion. Anyway, maybe I'm jealous, but I'm not jealous, no. I think I can be objective enough to recognize where there is greatness, and I don't think there is greatness in these towers. It's mimicked, even the top, you know, it's mimicked. They are not really real, you know. Anyway, but you do have the reasons to smile like this in this seductive way, Monsieur Libeskind. The Cabin Metro Hotel is a hotel, yes. What can we say? There is some visual drama here, but it serves the same wrong gods. The gods of money, and the gods of money, and of course, glamour. Hotel, cabin, metro. Very nice. Didn't I tell you that, you know, a young boy who was playing the harmonica in Poland arrived at this celebrity status, so he could afford cowboy boots made of lizard skin, you know, and I wonder what he sees in them, you know. Anyway, Sonnets of Babylon. This work I liked is a graphic work at the Venice Biennial some years ago, I don't know, 6-8 years ago, and they were done very nicely. I don't know the story behind it. It relates to Venice, but all these drawings or graphic works, now maybe he didn't do them alone, but I think they were impressive. Yes, so this man who builds a lot, also draws a lot and, you know, writes, and I think there is something to admire about him besides the, you know, some reservations I had, so to speak. You know, it's a different kind of deconstructivism here as compared to the early drawings that we saw in black and white and rather, you know, cold and, you know, with some kind of negative cerebrality. Here, things are getting to be more organic, although fragmentation still exists. I keep saying to the students and to anyone, including myself, work, play, invent, create, work with joy. And, you know, it's possible that at one moment, some form of what is called success will arrive. The important thing is to express oneself and to express the emotions, the spirit, the heart. He does this, you know, in various ways. Of course, he has the chance now, but he made this chance, you know. Here is the young boy. I like the way he smiles, you know. You feel like, you know, punching him on his cheek, you know. Look at him. Did he know at that time in 1955 that he will become a famous architect and that on his 75th birthday, some people in Bucharest will talk about him? I'm sure he didn't. Anyway, I love this picture. So I don't know what was before this word developing, but I will read the text if you allow me. We're approaching the end. Developing architecture beyond the traditional tautologies we are given historically, an architecture that is an architect that is dynamic and moving forward and operating in a new set of interests that are not just old modernist interests, but have to do with history, culture, literature, philosophy, with art in general. It is an exploration of creativity and the humanistic tradition of architecture, which means that architecture is, of course, a scientific field, a technical field, but it is equally part of the humanities in the sense of ideas, philosophy, literature, poetry, geometry, astronomy, and so on. Architizer, well, this was extracted from an interview with him. So Architizer asked him, what is your advice for young architects who might be in this experimental stage now as they progress to bigger projects and spaces? So this is what he answers. Take the risk. I'll say it a few times. Take the risk. Take the risk. Take the risk. Don't just get involved in the buildings, but pursue your ideas for your development, even if it just doesn't just have an immediate application. At the same time, I think that experiment is really fantastic because it does lead you, if you follow that path very rigorously and in a very disciplined way. I put a great value on this. Actually, I wouldn't call it experimental because experimental is more scientific. It either works or it doesn't. I would call it more of an adventure in the pursuit of your passion for architecture. And that will certainly lead you. If you are not surrounded by cynics, but by people who share your ideas and can discuss them with you, it's the best way to lead young architects to fantastic things. So again, take risks. I always tell young architects, pursue what you dream about. Don't be discouraged by cynics or skeptics. Surround yourself with interesting people. Keep going. You just have to have patience. There is no rush. It's not about quantity, it's about quality in my life anyway. I have been lucky. I could have expanded and doubled the amount of people. We had so many projects, but I said, no, let's not expand. Let's keep it so it's about architecture and not mass production. If I was not working on every project, if I was not involved fully, I wouldn't want to do it. It wouldn't be fun. So Zlota, 44, Europe's highest residential tower, which in my opinion is not great. It's this building here. And somehow, you know, I mean, maybe you could say that I have a deranged state of mind, but somehow I like more this building, which we have one very similar in Bucharest, former Casa Scânteii, than what he proposed, but and built. Anyway, what can I say? It's a tower, of course, but it's not really convincing. It's yes, it has a curvature to the left and to the right, but it's, again, I don't think he builds convincing towers. This is my perception. I like more that apartment building in Cincinnati, which plays with something like this, than what I see here. This is, I mean, I'm not against capriciousness, but this is, I would say, an uninspired capriciousness. But look at those people risking their lives, talking about taking risks. My God, how could they sit there and chat? You know, it's like unbelievable. Anyway, so old Warsaw and new Warsaw, the tallest apartment building in Europe. And this is also the sketch that architect said that it's a feeble sketch, and I would say it is. And the Military History Museum in Dresden. So we are not in the field of art, we are in the field of the military history. It's almost identical with what he did in Toronto, if you remember, which was a museum of art. And also similar to what he did in Denver, except that there was no old building like it is here. But this is almost identical to what he did in Toronto. And I don't think it's quite right. But I like the parapets of his stairs, which in a way show, you would say this was, and maybe is, I don't know. I actually wish they were left like this. Maybe this was just during the construction. I doubt it, or I don't know. Actually, some of the pictures here are taken during the construction. But I would have liked it to show the fragilities, the vulnerabilities that the war, the military machine brings unto us through such parapets. I wish he left them like this, but I'm afraid now, thinking twice, that this was just a temporary thing. I hope I'm wrong, because I see a lot of artifacts, if I am to call them so, covered with plastic. You know, they were not yet settled in the space of the museum. Somehow I wish that it was left like this, you know, to show in a way the disarray, the deconstruction, the destruction, the chaos that war brings unto us. But they probably, this was just temporary for the, you know, the building was not yet finalized. That these majestic stairs, they probably existed. War, I mean, I understood this kind of architecture when it was about art, but to do the same thing about the military, I think we have to have a talk, Mr. Libeskind, if you allow us. Anyway, this is the scheme seen from above. I mean, you know, this the modeling, conflict again, it is conflict. And the plan. This is his strategy. He has a rectangular, symmetrical or not context, and then he breaks it with the triangularities that bring in dynamism and revolt, and sometimes in a justifiable way, other times in a less justifiable way. The Congress Center in Mons in Belgium, which we already saw an image or two, now we'll see more. In my opinion, not one of his greatest works. It makes me think a little bit of Christian de Portzon Park in Luxembourg or Liechtenstein. No, not a very dramatic. And yes, this thing is the trademark. This is the signature, no? I think this is not a quality. If you are so kind to, I will end the presentation soon. Please be kind and turn off the microphone. Thank you. I like these drawings, though, the you know, these sections done digitally. I think they are very well done, and you know, shows the skill that exists in his office, without being extravagant. There is nothing extravagant here, but they are well done. The building itself, what can I do? Say it's. It doesn't surprise me, and I don't think it is a masterpiece. And this begins to tire one. After looking through so many works by him, you know, this repetition, this obsessional thing with it, it's just tiresome. The Keppel Bay residential towers in Singapore, we already saw a few images. Now we see others. Again, I consider them flaccid towers. But I'm sure people enjoy them. There is a lot of lux calme volupte there, of course, for the few chosen ones who make money who knows how. Maybe, you know, with financial speculations or winning through some scheme in Las Vegas, maybe, although casinos never lose, they always win. That's why they build skyscrapers and so on. That the chances are not 50-50. No, the casino always wins in the end. Now, I don't know what's going on here, but you can tell there is affluence, there is opulence. I'm not impressed. I'm not impressed. I wish he didn't build them. But he did. And the golf course, of course, it comes with a territory. No, you play golf. You know, even if you are Constantin Brâncuș, it's amazing to me that Brâncuș, after 60, he created almost nothing, and he played a lot of golf for almost 20 years. Very interesting case of a truly very important artist. I don't think there are too many artists like this in the history of art, where they just, after 60, they stop working in good measure and they play golf quite often. In fact, you can see the golf equipment in his atelier in front of Centre Georges Pompidou. We saw this sketch. Now, the National Holocaust Museum in Ottawa, which we saw an image of it's David Starr deformed. It's okay, built in concrete. It's okay, I think. It's an okay building. If this is a compliment, I'm not sure it totally is, but it's not a, so-called big mistake. It's not. So Canadians seem to like him, Chinese like him, people in Singapore like him, everybody likes him, Belgium likes him, the Americans like him, the Germans like him. In fact, he built an apartment building, and I'm afraid I don't have pictures with it here, in Berlin, which was finalized rather recently. He likes to work with triangles, obviously. So he is, as he was described, I don't know if the king, but close to being the king of the angle. But then also Zaha was, Zaha Hadid said, if there are 360 degrees, why are we using only one, meaning the 90 degrees one? Okay, so we are in Canada, and now we are truly approaching the end of the presentation. I'll show some sculptures by him, because as I said, in his later years, and in the present, he seems to enjoy doing sculpture. The Garden of Earthly Worries, interesting title, maybe inspired a little bit from Bruegel, who didn't use the word worries though, but he loves Peter Bruegel. This is in the Netherlands, so appropriately, this astonishing country which has incredible artists and incredible architects. So this is, you would say this is France, no? You would say this is André Le Nôtre, this is neoclassicism. Well, it's actually in the Netherlands, the 17th century, and here there are one, two, and I don't know where the other two are. Maybe this is the third, and maybe the fourth is here. Four sculptures that Libeskind planted there. So the Garden of Earthly Worries is a presentation of four abstract sculptures which explore the imbalance of humankind in nature. Each of the approximately 3 meter tall fragments of a globe represent different chemical compounds that contribute to our changing climate. Conceived as a sculptural and conceptual counterpoint to the ordered beauty of the palace garden, the gardens of the 17th century represent a perceived paradise, man's perfection of nature. But due to technology and human intervention, our current planet is rapidly changing. And he wanted with these sculptures to represent in a way the unsettling of the earth. So I'm glad he is aware of the issues that we are confronted with now. And I'm happy that he tries to have a role in this and to express his worries through art. Unfortunately, he also contributes to the very problems that we are trying to solve through this mega project of covering the earth as quickly as possible with asphalt, with concrete, and so on. And so isn't there a contradiction? Maybe the best way to be sustainable is to not build at all. But it seems we cannot abstain. We have to continue our assault on nature and on the earth. The crown. This is a big tower, a sculptural tower he built in Italy. Sorry, I misspelled, in Italy, in Casal Grande Padana. It's an interesting tower. It's you know, abstract, and it's quite big. You know, it's can we call it a sculpture? Yes. Can we call it a building? Yes. It's both a building and a sculpture. Somehow agreeing with Brincusch that a building is an inhabitable sculpture. Although I'm not totally convinced about this. Architecture is distinct from sculpture, but sculpturalness helps architecture. Anyway, this man obviously is in a privileged position. He can express himself adventurously, and now he doesn't take risks any longer. He took them at the right time, at the right place, and now he has a free ride, so to speak. Studio Libeskind did this other sculpture at the Venice Biennial, Facing Gaia. Description: Facing Gaia is presented in conjunction with the exhibition Time, Space, Existence at the Venice Architecture Biennial. The tower is located in the Giardini, it was located at the Giardini della Marinaresa, a public park adjacent to the entrance of the Giardini of Biennale. Reminiscent of ancient forms while employing advanced materials, the project explored the continuum of time, space, and existence through the relationship between the planet and humanity. Standing a 12 meters tall at the edge of the Adriatic Sea, the gleaming white monolithic tower is bisected by a floating amorphous void. The undulating mirror finished space in between represents the infinite and the finite, the possible and the impossible, while reflecting the surrounding gardens, water, and pedestrians. The title is derived from the concept that Gaia, the living earth, is at a moment of crisis. Humanity is at a crossroads in a world where we are running out of resources and space, in a moment where we are expanding with progressive technologies and the increasing capacity to connect. We are moving into a cultural shift from sustainability to viability. Facing Gaia stands as a beacon on the edge of this precipice. The studio collaborated with Grip Metal to fabricate the tower, employing future methods of construction. The facade was created using Grip Metal technology and was prefabricated in Toronto, Canada. The interior void was created with 3D printing technology and received its final finish in Venice with local craftsmen. And here it is. But reconsidering what he wrote, you wonder, how sustainable is it to create something in Toronto, something so big, and then send it with a lot of energy and expenditures and money and resources to Venice? So isn't there a contradiction? On one hand, we are complaining that the earth is ravaged by the excesses of the human being. And on the other hand, we are amplifying ourselves those excesses. And look at this tree, which I'm sure was intentional, maybe this one too. They were deformed in order to send a message. But the violence done to the trees, is it not actually amplifying the angst and the sad realities we are complaining about? These are contradictions which I do not quite understand. If you truly care about nature, why do you do this to the poor trees? Why, Mr. Libeskind, could you tell us, please, on your birthday, on your 75th birthday, please tell us, why are you torturing the trees to send a message? But is it enough justification? I don't think it is. It's still an assault of an arrogant human being on a humble nature, and we will pay the price, and we are paying it already. But there are things I don't understand. This man is aware of the conflict between man and nature, and yet he amplifies that conflict. Otherwise, yes, I kind of like this this sculpture with you know, I understand it. You know, it's the monolith, the phallic sculpture, the phallus of rationalism, and then it is broken in the middle or so by this irrational you know, fluidity. I understand. It's the erosion of a conviction. But strangely, his own convictions were not eroded. That's why he tormented the trees. Look what's going on here. You know, why? I'm alarmed, actually. So now we end, truly end, with three more images. He wants to express the effects of the pandemic on humankind in the context of the United States. So he cages Lady Liberty, you know, the Statue of Liberty, in 500,000 steel bars, because now a little more than, 500,000 people died in the United States because of COVID. And here it is, the Statue of Liberty, you know, covered with and encircled in this, you know, informal way, or how to describe it, you know, agitated for agitated way as well, with 500,000 metallic bars. But in my opinion, the pandemic is not the one that that affects our freedom. This appears to be so, but factually, it might be so, but in depth, I think things are much more complex. It's not because of the pandemic that we are not free. This is what I believe, you know. Yes, we cannot travel so easily. Yes, we cannot take the plane, but we could achieve a true freedom, the inner freedom, the spiritual freedom, by ravaging the earth less. So in a way, the pandemic is actually a medium through which we can achieve a higher sense of freedom, not the external freedom, but the interior freedom, the inner freedom. I wouldn't agree with what generated this project. And as for this drawing, which reminds me a little bit of, I don't know, for some strange reason, Raoul Dufy, it's so light that I actually don't see any shadow, you know, the shadow of liberty. I don't. He tried to express the entrapping, the imprisoning of the liberty because of the pandemic, but I am not convinced about this. Otherwise, again, we are dealing with conflict. On one hand, liberty; on the other hand, the prison. And he tried to convey his belief that the pandemic is killing, you know, the lady of freedom, and thus freedom. I'm not very convinced about this, and yet I like the fact that he is present in the present. In other words, he's addressing, how many architects do this? You know, do we think of the time we live in? Do we think of participating to the time we live in according to what is happening to us at this very moment? Not many of us do this. He's still trying to do it. And in this, I find there is something positive. And this is the last image of the presentation, maybe not chosen it in a most remarkable way. It's a fragment of this proposal. You see here the new World Trade Center, not as he imagined it, but as it was built by SOM. And here the red prison of the Lady of Liberty, which he thought might represent the effects of COVID, of the pandemic today. Happy birthday, Daniel Libeskind, and thank you for, you know, making us talk about you.
Thank you, Dan. Good night.